The Lord be with you. Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Savior Jesus on this wonderful day that the good Lord has given to us, that we can be here in his house, gather around his word, his sacraments, ready to receive his Easter blessings. So if you turn to your yellow pages, and I said that at first service, and it occurred to me, there's probably 20% of our congregation that has never seen or knows a yellow pages. But anyway. For you youngsters, that's where we used to find phone numbers before Google. But anyway, there's a lot to cover here, so I'm going to try not to take too much time with this. So let's just begin with the beginning. Next Saturday, you need to set your clocks ahead 1 hour. It's time to spring forward. So if you fail to do this, you will be late for church next week, next Sunday. And it's happened before that I'm up here preaching and, you know, giving it all I got up here. And I'll look up and I'll see someone walk in, and they kind of go, because they see me preaching and you guys all sitting here, and then they go like this, and then they go like this, and then they leave. Don't be that person, okay? Wednesday night, we're going to have church as we have our midweek Lenten services going for us here. So we'll have dinner at 6, pulled pork is the menu this week. Church will be at 7. Our theme this year is a Lenten journey with Joseph. Then, I'm flipping pages here, so 2 weeks from today after this service, we are going to have a time of trying to fix stuff that's broken in the church and get the church all spiffed up for Easter. So there's an actual sign-up sheet back there, and I have been asked to ask you that if you're planning on attending, please just don't walk up to Sheila or Bob or John and say, I'll be there. Please write it down so that we have a good, accurate count of who's going to be there. Okay, so as always, the more hands we have, the easier the work. Okay, then obviously we're in Lent, so Easter is coming up in 6 weeks. So if you'd like to take part in an Easter choir, if you would like to take part in an Easter bell choir, please talk to me or Erica, and we will get you set up. But obviously, we would like to have special music for the biggest day of the year. Then March Madness Men's Fellowship will be a week from Friday at my house, starting at 6 o'clock. I'm going to go get brisket, I'm going to go get sausage, and you guys can bring whatever you want to bring with that. I will also have in my refrigerator liquid German bread, if you know what I mean. So you don't have to bring that unless there's a special kind that you like to drink. So we will be getting together, we'll have some fun, we'll eat some food, we'll watch some hoops, and who knows, maybe the Badgers will be playing that Friday night, and hopefully we'll see a win, because hopefully today the Badgers will win the Big Ten title for the regular season today. LWML is going to be having a meeting this Saturday on March 12th at 10 a.m. So in the church library. So ladies, hope you join for that. Script orders are being taken today, so if you need some gift cards, Judy is here to set you up. And script is on this end. Table over here. Okay. And then sitting on my right, your left, third row is Herr Schreiner, and if you're not aware of this, Keith retired a few months ago. They have sold their house and they are moving back to Frankenmuth, which is where he's from. They're moving tomorrow, so this is Keith's last Sunday with us here. He's been a member of this church for 29 years. 29 years. And in his tenure here, he's been a chairman, a vice chairman, an elder, a treasurer. He was on lawn mowing team. He took part in our golf outings. He used to be in fantasy football. He usually came to the basketball thing. So, your name is on the plaque back there. That's right. Your name is on the plaque back there. So anyway. On behalf of the congregation, and I hope they will talk to you after the service today, but thank you for all of your service, because it's a lot. And on a personal level, I want to thank you for having my back and being my friend. God bless you, sir. I promised him I wouldn't get mushy, so that's as mushy as I'm going to get. All right. And then also, you should have gotten an email on Friday that said that we're going to take a collection for Lutheran World Relief for helping the situation in Ukraine. And so that middle basket back there, we've got three back there today. The one in the middle is for the Ukraine fund. And if you're going to use a check, simply make the check out to St. Mark Lutheran Church, and then on the memo line write Ukraine, and then we'll just send one church, one check to Lutheran World Relief. The thing you got said there was going to be matching money. Apparently that got matched very quickly, but we're still going to collect the funds. And it is my belief that the majority of this money is going to go to Poland to help in the provide stuff for the refugees. Okay. Anything I'm forgetting or neglecting? Yes, ma'am. Anything else I'm forgetting or neglecting? Okay, so then it's birthdays. Weston Edwards, you're here. Where are you? You're back in the corner. Weston, you got a birthday today. Happy birthday, sir.
Happy birthday, Bob.
All right, so you're 16, right? Going to get your driver's license today? No? Okay. That's a joke, obviously. Not much of one. Jack McKinnon has his birthday today. And Trey Rudat. Trey Rudat, where are you at?
He's
at camp. Okay. And then Ann Seeley has a birthday tomorrow, so Ann, if you're watching online, happy birthday. Eli Merchant has a birthday Wednesday, Ruth Avery on Thursday, and Max Toll, if you're watching online, happy birthday on Friday. Okay. All right, I believe that covers our introductory stuff. Okay. So let's turn to our first song here this morning, Lord Have Mercy. That's a good song to start Lent with, right? And God bless our worship together this morning. congregation will please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, but with you there is forgiveness. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your punishment now and forever. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for our song of praise. The Old Testament reading for the second Sunday in Lent is from Jeremiah chapter 26. When Jeremiah had finished speaking all that the Lord had commanded him to speak to all the people, then the priests and the prophets and all the people laid hold of him, saying, "Oops, that's next week." Let's try that again. The Old Testament reading for the first Sunday in Lent is from Deuteronomy chapter 26. When you come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance and have taken possession of it and live in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground which you harvest from your land that the Lord your God is giving you. And you shall put it in a basket, and you shall go to the place that the Lord your God will choose to make his name to dwell there. And you shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "I declare today to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our fathers to give us." Then the priest shall take the basket from your hand and set it down before the altar of the Lord your God. And you shall make response before the Lord your God. "A wandering Aramean was my father, and he went down into Egypt and sojourned there, few in number. And there he became a nation, great, mighty, and populous. And the Egyptians treated us harshly and humiliated us and laid on us hard labor. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers. And the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with great deeds of terror, with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And behold, now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground, which you, O Lord, have given me. And you shall set it down before the Lord your God and worship before the Lord your God. And you shall rejoice in all the good that the Lord your God has given to you and to your house, you and the Levite and the sojourner who is among you." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
O come, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame,
and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
The epistle this morning is from Romans chapter 10. The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, that is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, "Everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame." For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing his riches on all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is the word of the Lord. We stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the fourth chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days. And when they were ended, he was hungry. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone." And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time, and said to Jesus, "To you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I will give it to whom I will. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." And Jesus answered him, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." And he took Jesus to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said to Jesus, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you, and on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." And Jesus answered him, "It is said, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven,
and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures,
and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated, and we will now sing our new song of the month.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The text for your sermon this morning, the biblical basis for our thoughts together here today, are the words of the Old Testament reading, which I read to you, the second Old Testament reading I read to you. Deuteronomy chapter 26, beginning with verse 1.
There's a shadow over the land. Evil and murder and darkness are all around. There's the stench of fear, and the ground shakes with those who march for war.
That's as good as I can do an English accent, I'm sorry. Anybody recognize that line? It's from Tolkien, second book, Lord of the Rings trilogy. And it's at the Battle of Helm's Deep. And this is when King Theoden says, "And so it begins." Well, today's the first Sunday in Lent. And each year we enter this journey of Lent for 40 days. And in the season of Lent, we focus on the journey from baptismal font to the grave and our need for forgiveness of our sins. Now, in our text today, God commands Israel to remember their journey from slavery in Egypt to the Promised Land, the freedom that they were going to have there. And it put life in perspective for Israel. And Lent does that for us. Because as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, focusing on our journey with Jesus to the cross and the empty tomb, this enables us to fear no evil, even though evil and murder and darkness are all around, like I started here. For we are united with Jesus. So as God commanded Israel in our text, so it is with us this week, whether you were here for our Ash Wednesday service or you're just starting your Lent here today, we enter the Lenten journey once again. And our text tells us where we're going. And so it begins. So our text is a sermon that Moses preached to all of Israel before they went into the Promised Land. It's part of a sermon that he preached. And this was, Deuteronomy is basically a series of sermons that Moses preached before the Israelites went into Canaan. And he told Israel to remember their slavery, which they had left 40 years earlier. The Egyptians treated us harshly and humiliated us and laid on us hard labor. Verse 6. And if you don't remember, Joseph, who's one of the sons of Jacob, had become second to Pharaoh, but Joseph died. And the people of Israel had grown great in number. And there was a new Pharaoh who ruled over Egypt. And this was a Pharaoh who was threatened by the number of Israelites that were coming up out of Goshen. And so Egypt put them to work and forced them into to hard labor and basically made them slaves. And their lives became bitter, making bricks and mortar to build the Egyptian infrastructure and to build the Egyptian empire. So whenever people read that, they ask, had God not seen the affliction and suffering of his people? Had he not heard their cries over the evil treatment of Pharaoh and the whips of the taskmasters? And the answer is, he did. But the people didn't see that. When God did send Moses to deliver his people, and he shows up there before this Pharaoh, and he says, "Let my people go," the Pharaoh's heart became hardened, and just out of spite, he said, "Well, you know what? If you're going to try and rescue these Israelites, I'm going to make their work even harder." And so when Moses showed up, the lives of the Israelites got worse. And as you can imagine, that did not go over very well. Now, I have to tell you that, and I don't think it's going to be big news to you, I mean, this Pharaoh was a bad dude. He was evil. And if you want to know what was the name of this Pharaoh, because as I was preparing this sermon for you, I'm like, I should really figure out what the name of this Pharaoh was, because it wasn't Yul Brynner. You've got to be old enough to have seen that movie. But the first article I pulled up on the internet to figure this out, I knew I was in trouble reading this article, because the first thing this author said was, if you want to figure out who the Pharaoh was during the Exodus, first, you have to ask yourself, did the Exodus really happen, since that's in the Bible? And I'm like, okay, new article, so clicked away. Yep, right? So anyway, there are basically two times that are considered that for the Exodus to have happened. The Bible says it happened in about 1420 BC, all right? And so that would mean that a guy named Thutmose III, I dare any of you to name a child, a grandchild, Thutmose. And maybe it's Tutmose, I don't know. But anyway, it's T-H-U-T-M-O-S-E. So Thutmose III was the pharaoh. Now, and I don't like using this term, but the liberal time, for those that don't believe in the biblical timeline, they think the Exodus happened in 1200 B.C., if it happened. And that would mean that Ramses II was the pharaoh. So if you remember the movies, in all the movies, the pharaoh's named Ramses. And that's not what the Bible teaches. So file that away. Anyway. So this pharaoh, who we believe was Thutmose III, Cyril of Jerusalem, who was an early church writer, he wrote to the Christians in the 4th century and said that that pharaoh was kind of a type, kind of a figure, kind of a precursor for, or a picture of Satan, who is the worst guy, the worst bad guy. And obviously when we talk about Lent, we talk about the devil because we talk about sin and we talk about temptation, and that was the gospel reading today when Jesus was tempted. And so the devil is very clever, and he uses slyness and treachery to fight against you and wear you down. Because, you know, we as a church, we believe the devil exists and he's real. There are some churches out there that aren't saying that. There are some churches out there saying there's no such thing as sin. Those churches need to read their Bible a little better, but moving on. So the devil sets the riches of the world before you like he set the kingdoms of the world before Jesus. By the way, when the devil said, you know, these are mine to grant, he was lying. The devil lies a lot. But the devil sets the riches of the world before us, and soon we're tempted to make them our idol for 70 or 80 years. And then we lose the promised land of eternal life with Jesus. And by this I'm saying, I'm sure that we all know somebody in our lives or knew somebody in our lives who loves or loved money more than anything else. I know that when I think about the 60 years I've been on this earth, I knew a few people that money was the most important thing to them. The devil whispers in the ears of evil people to get them to deceive you, to lie to you, to hurt you. And the devil enjoys seeing when we're sick. He tries to get you to doubt. He wants you to focus on your fears. All of these things the devil does so that you would turn away from God and die and end up with him. But then getting back to Moses and his sermon, Israel then reconfirms her commitment. Then we cried to the Lord, the God of our fathers, and the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. And that's something that Lent does. Lent confronts us with our sin, as they were confronted with theirs. The sin that enslaves us to the evil one, to the devil in the first place. And so we read today in the gospel where Jesus was in the wilderness and was tempted hard by the devil, but Jesus fought back harder. And then we look at ourselves, and we know the many times that the devil has come at us, and we didn't even put up a fight. So the prophet Joel tells us as we begin our Lenten journey, return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. That's Joel chapter 2. So John the Baptist cries out in the wilderness, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So Jesus' very first words recorded in Mark's gospel are, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe in the gospel. And so every Sunday in our services, we begin in confession and repentance to our merciful God. Now we have an advantage each Lent that the Israelites didn't have back then because we know the end of our journey. We know how our story is going to turn out because Jesus Christ's cross and empty tomb tells us that, right? We know God's grace and mercy and love for his naughty children who listen to Satan way too often. We know Jesus turned aside all of Satan's temptations so that his obedience now counts for us. We know the power of the cross, which is forgiveness for all the sins of everyone in all the world. And so at the beginning of this Lenten journey, at the beginning of each new journey in life that takes us to old age, at the beginning of each new day, at the beginning of each Sunday service here, we go to Jesus. And we come before the Lord, and we confess our sins, and we receive absolution. And throughout our journey in life, we know that He forgives us. And now we go back one more time to Moses and his sermon, where Israel remembers God's deliverance. Verses 8 and 9 of your text today. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. He brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. And I don't know if you know this or realize this, but the Holy Land of Canaan was promised to Abraham 680 years before our text. 680 years between the time when God had given the promise and when He delivered the promise. And there were times to God's people when it seemed nearly impossible that God could or should make good on His promise. Because, you know, how many sins do you see in the Old Testament, right? Abraham sinned often. Jacob tricked his father for the inheritance that belonged to his brother Esau. The sins of Jacob's sons led Joseph and the Israelites into Egypt for hundreds of years. But here's the thing, and I've told you this before, and I will tell you again. God always makes good on His promises. Always. For the Israelites back then, God sent Moses to Pharaoh with His direct command, "Let my people go." And after many plagues and Pharaoh's hardened heart, and then the death of the firstborn of everyone there in Egypt with the Passover and Israel's doors marked with blood, Pharaoh was no match for God. And he let the people go. But not so fast, my friends. Because Satan and sin and death don't give up that easy. And so Satan kept working on Pharaoh, and Pharaoh changed his mind. And he pursued Israel to the banks of the Red Sea. And Israel was trapped and doomed. And there was the stench of fear, and the ground shook with those who marched for war, like we began, you know. But then God told Moses to stretch his arm over the Red Sea, and God divided the water so that Israel passed through on dry ground. And Pharaoh's army and chariots chased and pursued them. And again, through the outstretched arms of Moses, God brought the water over the Egyptians, upon their chariots, upon their horsemen, and they were all killed. And Israel was now on their journey to the land that God had promised, the land flowing with milk and honey. And God delivered Israel out of Egypt into the promised land. But all of this is a foreshadowing of the eternal salvation that sinners of sinners and the restoration of all creation which Jesus did for us. And this is the point I'm trying to make to you today, that what we see happening with the Israelites, with Moses, is a little tiny small way compared to what Jesus did for us. Okay? So Moses was sent from God to Egypt as Jesus was sent from heaven into this world. Moses was to lead a people in bondage out of Egypt. Jesus came to rescue us all from under the bondage, the slavery of sin. Moses was to paint the blood of a lamb upon his doorpost to avoid death at the Passover. Jesus came to shed His blood and to save your soul and mine. And now eternal death passes over us. While with the outstretched arm of Moses, God delivered Israel from that devilish Pharaoh, with outstretched arms, God in the flesh hung on the cross, taking the place of us all. So our Lenten journey, therefore, turns into our Easter eternity. So what I want you to remember from this sermon today is, you know, we saw, you know, God using Moses to save His people Israel, that they were slaves in Egypt, and then God delivered them and brought them to the promised land and a new life there. And Jesus does something like that, only bigger, because Jesus came and rescued us from the slavery we have to sin. And because He died on the cross and rose again, He has brought us out of that state of enslavement and has delivered us now to heaven, to His kingdom. Because, you know, Lent only lasts for a moment. I realize it's 40 days, but that's not long compared to a lifetime. And Easter lasts a lifetime. Easter is forever. And this is our baptismal faith, that while we live on this earth, we live in Lent and Easter at the same time. And we sin, and we grieve, and we suffer, and we repent, just like we saw the Israelites do. But then in the waters of your baptism and my baptism, daily we are forgiven. Daily we are saved. We are bound for heaven. That's where we're going. So if you take the time to stop and think about it, as we have done here today, Lent is a microcosm of life's journey from birth to grave. And we enter this Lent with the confidence of God's love for us in Jesus Christ as he journeyed from the cross and to the cross and rises from the dead for us, because he rescued us and he saves us eternally, and he is going to take us to his eternal kingdom. Today we have our first Sunday in Lent. And so it begins again. In the name of Jesus, amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, may keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We now stand for the prayers and petitions of our congregation. Lord Most High, for the sake of Jesus, who suffered temptation and death for our redemption, be our refuge. Preserve us from every evil and plague, and strengthen us in faith so that we might be satisfied with your salvation. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, in the midst of this life we run into many temptations. Fix our eyes on our Lord Jesus, who bore temptation for us and resisted to the point of death, and brings us through the evils of this fallen world to dwell with you forever. Lord, in your mercy. Father in heaven, your Son trampled the serpent underfoot and freed us from sin and death by his own death on the cross. Protect and preserve all whom you call to preach Christ and him crucified. Command your angels concerning them, guard them in all their ways, and bear them up for the sake of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, govern the kingdoms of this world according to your holy and gracious will. Protect authorities from every temptation of the devil who falsely claims sovereignty over them, and equip them to curb what is evil and promote what is good. We ask you to be with our country, that you'd be with our leaders, and that they would seek your wisdom, and that we would be more united in these United States. And we also pray for those around the world, especially those in Eastern Europe, as we think of the conflict between Russia and the Ukraine and all of the refugees streaming east. We also ask you to protect our troops, including Thomas and Chris, Preston and Evan, Cannon, Teresa, David and Maya, Grant, Chris, David and John, Ben, Debbie, Seth and Vanessa, Kendon, Christian and Matthew. Lord, in your mercy. God of all mercy, you answer those who call upon you. Hear our prayers for all who are in need of healing and restoration. We pray for all those who are printed in our bulletin insert here this morning. We also pray for David Shooter, and we pray for Leanne Toll, who was at home recovering from surgery this past week. We now take a moment and pray silently in our hearts for all those that we know to be in need of the blessings given by Jesus. Be with them in their trouble and rescue them according to your gracious will. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, unite your people in a right confession of your word, and thus freed from disagreement over your truth, bring us with penitent hearts to receive the great riches of your Son's body and blood. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you've had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may be seated now for our distribution. We stand for prayer. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift, and we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for our closing song, 10,000 Reasons. God's people said,
Amen.
God be with you. It was good to have you here today. Thank you for joining us. So God be with you today and this week.